Many thanks for inviting me for this program. And I must admit that this kind of talk is not expected to be a very structured talk. And I expect that it will be very interactive at the end. And the opinions that I am going to share with you are very subjective and personal. So do not think that, you know, these can be generalized, and I will and I always respect other viewpoints as well. Teaching is always very subjective, you know. I mean, Professor Guha was mentioning that we have an excellent system of teaching feedback, and this is very important. But at the same time, I mean, it always doesn't make much of a sense to relate or correlate the impact of the teaching with, you know, the kind of feedback, because feedback may depend on many things. It is not just how good a teacher you are, but several other factors that influence the minds of the students. Sometimes I give more emphasis on subjective feedbacks. This is also another important aspect that we have in our system, where, you know, teachers are given some feedback which are in sentences or in small phrases, so that it is something which comes out of a thought process rather than, you know, checking multiple choice types of things. So, I mean, feedback may be deceptive, feedback may be useful in whatever way you want to interpret, but it all depends on, I think, if you have been teaching over years. I believe all of you, I mean, most of you are teachers. I can see some of the audience as our own students, so I take them apart, but most are teachers. I believe this is, everybody is a teacher. So, I think, I mean, you agree or not, but the greatest assessment of you will come from your students. I mean, you may agree, you may not agree. Some teachers say that my teaching is very good, but students do not appreciate. And I mean, it can be a communication problem. Maybe the teacher is excellent in his or her own domain, but the teacher cannot effectively communicate. But there could also be other issues, not just a matter of communication or not just a matter of knowing the subject. There could be things beyond that. And I would like to discuss some of those things as I go ahead today. So these are the points. Actually, this is not a presentation, but, you know, in case I forget some of the points, so I have listed the points here so that we will touch upon these points one after the other and give some examples at the end. So now I will start with something. Actually, I gave a similar talk in a similar program a few years back, and after that many things have changed. And one important thing that has changed is that we have advanced more into the Google era. So, not that few years before Google era was not there, but now, I mean, we have advanced significantly. So when we have advanced significantly, the issue is that how do we teach students considering the huge amount of information which is available in the electronic media. So, I want to share, or I want to discuss in depth about this, because this is, I think, the biggest challenge that as teachers everybody faces these days. So on a bit of a light note, when I was a university student, now that kind of designation is not there. There used to be designations of teachers as lecturer, reader, professor, this type of thing, which is now, of course, starting with assistant professor, associate professor and all. So many of you already know about this, and I mean some of you might have gone through this kind of transition. So as students, we lightly used to say that who is a lecturer? A lecturer is typically in those days a very bright young faculty member. Many of them at that time were not having their own PhDs, so they will work very hard day and night. They will prepare the lectures nicely and utter whatever they have learned or whatever they could synthesize. Reader is bit of a senior, so reader, what he will do, he will read from the book. That is why the name reader. And professor is beyond all this, so he will give some general gyan like what I am giving and get away with that. So in those days and typically in older times, we used to say that somebody is very knowledgeable if somebody can reproduce information or data. And typically our best history teachers were those who used to say that, in this year this battle was fought. So we used to, excellent history teacher knows that in which year which battle was fought. Our excellent life science teachers were those who could draw excellently the alimentary system of a toad. So so these were our excellent teachers in school. Now we have to recognize that those kinds of situations cannot prevail anymore. I have tested myself in one of my thermodynamics classes. I was teaching a topic in thermodynamics, because this is a general audience, I don't want to get into technical issues much, but thermodynamics is a well known topic, at least to this audience. So I was teaching some topic, and then what I was doing is I was trying to work out a problem or something where some particular data was needed. So in older times, as teachers, we always used to carry material which had these data and all these things, because without that data you cannot really go ahead with solving the problem, and students do not understand how to do that. So there was a because of some urgency or what, I forgot to carry that data. So there were students who were chatting with their friends. There are many such students who are there in the class, who are there in the class to give physical attendance. And although I do not respect any physical attendance, and I don't simply care as a teacher who is coming to the class or not, just for the sake of coming to the class. So, but there will be always some students who feel that class is a very nice place to hide and do their own work. So some such student was there, and he was doing something with his smartphone. So I said that, could you quickly get into the Wikipedia on this topic and let me know that what is the value of this property. And he immediately told. So he was very happy that he was given this kind of activity in the class. See, as most teachers, you will feel very depressed, all your face will become red if you see some student sitting in the class with a smartphone and doing something. You believe that world has fallen on your head. Your entire dominance is lost, world of dominance is lost. So don't think like that. It's not a matter of establishing your dominance over a student. There is a certain objective and you want to fulfill that objective. So that objective is a part of the teaching learning process. So then you engage that student with something. You say that, you look into the net and give me this information. And that student gave me that information. And he was then very proud, he thought that, what kind of teacher we are having these days, he cannot remember these properties, so now I can give this. He returns with a sense of satisfaction that yes, he has contributed something. So nowadays teaching is very challenging because whatever you want to teach, the material part of it will be available in the net. Even the demonstrative part of it through NPTEL lectures and all those things, or even, I mean, lectures from other open courseware systems like MIT open courseware and all, they are all available in the net, freely downloadable. People can watch these. You have e-copies of all books. All our students know that how to bypass the security and download these books free of cost. So, everything is available. So, as a physical teacher, what value will you add when you go to the class? This is something you must have a mental preparation for that. And if you don't have a mental preparation for that, I think the whole purpose is beaten. So, I have seen many teachers, even now, they are literally, copying notes from somewhere or making slides with downloadable things from the net and giving to the students. What value does it add? Simply you say that you download from this URL and that's all. So, then their ego is not satisfied. So, when we were students, even though Google era was not there, but a similar thing was there, but simply because we did not have access to this material, we thought that this teaching is very important. So, I realized over time that there was a particular period when as a teacher, you are teaching the same subject, your notes have started becoming from white to yellow. Then to make it back to white, what you do is you go to a Photoshop, photocopy center and get it photocopied. Once you get it photocopied, the beautiful thing is that old yellow things again become white. So then you can pass it on generation after generation and make people feel that what a great thing you are doing. So that kind of environment is no more there. So we have to, as teachers, we have to understand that what value we can add beyond the material available in the net. And to me, the most important value addition is like enabling them to read between lines, to get a concept. It is not so easy. So, like for example, my common teaching subjects are I am basically a teacher in mechanical engineering. So, my common teaching subjects are fluid mechanics, thermodynamics, heat transfer, these kinds of subjects. And I have seen that there are so many conceptual issues about these subjects which create ambiguities in the minds of the students. And it is very important that you pick up these and deliberate on these in details. So that will always supplement what is already there in the book. So I don't think that with the advent in technology, the role of a teacher is lost. But the role of a teacher has to be redefined. It cannot be defined in the way how it was done earlier. So, for example, asking students thought-provoking questions. Questions which can stimulate their minds. Questions which will force them to go beyond their limits. Assignments which will force them to go beyond their limits. This is the kind of approach, at least in some of the best places that you have to do. The second thing is teach and don't preach. So this is a typical problem with our Indian system, that whenever you become a teacher, you believe that you are a god and your students are like disciples. So, like a priest in the church, you start talking about things and it's a one-way process where you believe that what you know is the ultimate thing. Try to learn telling your students what you don't know. This is very important. Sometimes it can hurt your ego, because I mean, as teacher you expect that you are better, but imagine, understand that as a law of genetic evolution, your students have a better mind than you. It has to be. It is as per the law of genetic evolution, and it cannot be denied. No matter how good you are, your students are expected to be better than you. No matter how good Sachin Tendulkar was, it doesn't mean that Virat Kohli has to be worse than that. I mean, it doesn't de-dignify Sachin Tendulkar, right? I mean, he remains as an iconic figure, even if Virat Kohli surpasses with all the record and all. But you have to give due credit to the coming generation. So they have their sharp minds, and do not undermine that. So you share with the students about some of your experience about unsolved problems in the domain, and that is where teaching, actually good teaching, combines with good research. So there are many people who think that teaching is such an art where research is irrelevant. There, that kind of teaching means you are restricted with whatever is written in the book. But there are many topics in the domain for which actually there are many unsolved problems. And if you have gone little bit into the research in that domain, even if you have not yourself done a lot of research, but if you have studied research issues and research materials, you will yourself know that what are the unsolved problems, and try to share some of these unsolved problems with your students. And I mean, many times, see, I teach an advanced level course which is called as microfluidics. So in microfluidics lectures, at least for some part of the lecture, I try to make sure that I tell the students that these are certain problems which we have not been able to solve till now. So these are open problems. It is up to you to take up the challenge. Maybe our generation could not do it, but your generation will be able to do it. That is how research progresses. So these kinds of, you know, openness in interacting with the students should be there. It should not be like a God disciple type of relationship. You must respect the abilities of the students. You must share with them what is challenging, what is yet to be solved, and I think that can motivate some of the students. We have always heard that best teachers are the best motivators, and motivation cannot just come by a management type of motivational talk, right? Motivation should come from the technical discussions. The topic that you are going through, that issues on that topic themselves, if those are highlighted, that these are certain emerging topics for the future, if you want to work on that, you must learn these basics. So that kind of thing, this kind of creating this kind of motivation, it is this is very, very important. So I will give you one typical example of giving motivation in teaching. So I was Alexander von Humboldt fellow in one university in Germany, and there my mentor was a very senior professor, Professor Franz Durst, who is very well known in the domain of fluid dynamics. Now he is, of course, close to 80 years old, so he is not very active, but I mean, when we were very in our very early stage of the career, he was one of the top figures in the world. So one day I was having a cup of coffee with Professor Durst, and Professor Durst told that, how do you teach fluid mechanics? So then I said that, I mean, this is the way in which, the traditional way. So he said that, see, in India the problem is, because the population is large, even if you want to do it little bit differently, you cannot. The other problem is that in India, the system is so structured and students are, you know, so much trained to follow what the teachers are saying. What you tell is going to, ultimately students will be accepting it. But in European countries, most students do not, at least undergraduate students, do not have mind actually to study. They, because of the affluence and social impacts and other things, they don't want to study serious subjects until and unless that student is very, very motivated, but that will be only 1%. But a class cannot go on with one student. So his subject, this subject of fluid mechanics, requires, you know, dealing with differential equations. And if you start with those dealing with the differential equations, the famous differential equations in fluid mechanics like the Navier-Stokes equation, then 99% of the German students in the first class, they will go away and they will never come. So in the Indian system, it is okay. I mean, we know that these students are mathematically sharp otherwise, because our training in mathematics in school is very good. And not only that, they will, I mean, they are trained to adapt to whatever they are being taught in the class, because it is the nurturing process in Indian cultured families is that we teach our children that, you know, education is one of the ways by which you can make your life. So they will going through this. So Professor Du said that what I do, you know, I first take these students for an expedition to Alps. So of course, these students are very affluent, they can pay their expenses of the trip. Then these students will, so he will take them there, have some fun, drink together. There the culture is like that. I mean, professors can fail students, but on the same evening they will have drink with that student. So so they will all enjoy, have a party, and he will show that, see, this glacier coming down and doing all these, this is all fluid mechanics, you know, this is like, so everybody will be very excited thinking that all these things are very beautiful natural things and this is fluid mechanics. Then after 2 weeks, he will come back and say that, so you have seen what is fluid mechanics in nature. Now to understand this, you have to do some simple mathematics. So then he starts with, you know, these working on these differential equations. Eventually he covers the material that he intends, that nobody stops him from that. But he starts with a different background. He doesn't start immediately, let us start with the Navier-Stokes equation. So he gives a perspective that why do you learn that? Why do you think that it is going to be useful? So that is very important. So motivation has to be very clear. That is my third point. So people who are good in pedagogy will say that we will essentially list down learning objectives. So for example, like if I read this, what are the objectives that I fulfill? But from my experience, I have seen that most of these learning objectives are very artificial. Though these are artificially worked out to fill up the pedagogy forms, but nothing more than that. So you have to bring in real objective, realistic motivation, realistic objective, not something for the sake of, you know, making bullet points for the objective. Some objective which will create an impact in the mind of the student. That kind of objective must be there. So these learning objectives must be cleared, but the learning objectives need not be as formalized as the, you know, pedagogical requirements are demanding. These may be very informal objectives. Like for example, fluid mechanics. Learning objective, we will learn how a river flows. We will learn how blood is flowing through arteries and veins. So these kind of simple things which can relate with the you know, practical thing that is happening in life, not a very structured formal pedagogical statement. And this is where I have a bit of a conflict with, you know, the people who are, you know, specialized in pedagogy. I mean, they will say that, you know, these things are important, but I mean, I agree that these things are important, but one should not overdo it. Like, students should not feel that, you know, pedagogy is another set of items that they have to memorize. Learning objective, right? So, learning objective should not be another set of, you know, questions that come in the exam. What is your learning objective? Okay, that should come spontaneously. I mean, so if anybody has gone through fluid mechanics course and people ask him, you know, why are you learning fluid mechanics? That kind of answer some kind of spontaneous answer should come out. It should not be very artificial. Then the next point, I believe, is the most important point. Good teaching requires an excellent grasp on fundamentals. Without this, no pedagogy will work. Okay. So, I have seen this typically happens in school, and that is why I would say that school level education for most cases is actually a failure. The reason is that many people who are teaching in school, I see the difference between our era when we were school students and the present era. When we were school students, not many teachers used to have formal degrees in education, but they used to teach excellently. Because whatever they knew, they used to have excellent grasp over that, and they tried to make the most out of it. Now the system is very much degree based. So if you have a degree in education, but you are third class in mathematics, still also it is okay. You are entitled to teach mathematics, and then, you know, you teach your students in the school class what is HCF, what is LCM, all these things. I can still remember these things are taught, but no motivation. Why should you learn what is HCF, what is LCM? Can you give an answer to this? All of you have. So this is a junior school level arithmetic. Now why should I learn HCF? Why should I learn LCM? Why should I learn that, you know, if there is a bamboo and there is a monkey which is going up and down, and bamboo is oiled? I mean, all of us have solved this problem, so you can relate this with this. So the motivation has to be there, the fundamentals also have to be very clear. Actually, the motivation will come if the fundamentals are very, very strong. So as a colleague teacher of you, I would stress upon you that if you want to be a good teacher, and I am sure most of you are very good teachers, and if you want to be a good teacher, you first start strengthening your fundamentals. So if you believe, I can tell you that when all of us have started our journey as a teacher, the first thing that we have done is we revisited what we studied as our students in our own student life. And then you will find that there are lots of gaps. The reason is that in our student lives, we were more, you know, concerned about the questions that will be asked in the exam, and we tried to prepare accordingly, even if we were among the best of the students. But when you are a teacher, you know, you face deeper challenges, because nobody will ask you to address or answer exams, but you have a greater challenge. One student told me that, sir, I was asking him to do some research work, and he said, sir, it is very difficult because we are having exams and all this. I say that as teacher, we have exams every day. At least you have exams only once or twice in the semester, but I face exams every day, because every day when I go to the class, I think it is my exam, my test of how I can communicate the things effectively to students. So this kind of, facing this kind of exam requires a different level of preparation. it is not the same level of preparation what you had made when you were students. Just I will take some water. So, this kind of preparation to make your fundamentals clear is very important, and for that take whatever measures that may be necessary. For example, you can go through good NPTEL courses or good online other online courses, available material in the net. You can consult with your colleagues. By colleagues, I do not just mean colleagues from your own institutes, but any teacher who is teaching the same subject in other institutes, and you know that he or she is a very effective teacher in that subject. So you try to take whatever help necessary, but try to clarify your fundamentals. Do not simply care about the presentation of your material. First you understand the best, next will come the presentation. So if you understand the best, you cannot be amongst the worst of the teachers. You may not be the best of the teachers, but if you are actually not doing well in your teaching, and if you believe that you are one of the worst of the teachers, then actually there is something wrong with your fundamentals. That you must be very clear about. I mean, that should come from your conscience. Nobody will tell you that your fundamentals are bad, but believe me or not, your students will understand. They may not express it in the way in which you might expect, but they will know it. Refrain from overuse and abuse of modern gadgets. So again, I am sharing some of my experiences of teaching at IIT Kharagpur. So I joined in IIT Kharagpur in August 2002, so I have completed good 15 years. So I have almost become 50% mad. So when you complete 30 years of teaching, you become full mad. So at least you will learn how to forgive my irrationality when I talk about these things. So when I first started taking fluid mechanics classes, so I was very young at that time, so I thought that using modern gadgets would be excellent. So I thought that I will make my presentations in PowerPoint and teach students based on those materials, and it would have helped me also in many ways, because same slides I could have used year after year, and also lots of standard slides are available in the net, so you could download it, just change the color, background color, and it becomes your own slide. So this is a trick what many teachers use. So I was very happy with it. So in the class, but before teaching, I asked students in the class. I said that I give you two options. One is I will be using PowerPoint slides for teaching these. The other is I will use the traditional chalk and talk system to teach this. What would you prefer? Believe me or not, more than 98% students said that they want the traditional chalk and talk thing. So and these are some of the best students in the country. Don't think that these students do not know technology, they have absolutely no idea of what is going on, and all this. So then even one student said that, sir, we have gone through some first year courses and we have learnt, this is a second year level course, and we have learnt enough is enough. Do not, please do not cheat us by flashing one slide after the other in front of us. A clear statement. I am not naming the student, I can still remember who he is, and he is now very, very established and living in a very good place. So then I gave a thought over it. I said that okay, I should respect your thoughts, and then I realized that actually what students are meaning is something like this. So you should not take that thing as something which is having a full sanctity. You have to understand the perspective. So in a subject where you have many mathematical equations, then one equation flashed after the other will actually not allow the students to understand the chronology in which things are derived. But you have a blank board, in that you start writing, and the student's mind is actually following how you are doing it. Even if you are making a mistake, it's okay. I have seen that in many of my classes, I have made some mistakes in, you know, doing algebraic manipulation. Of course, at that level, we are not supposed to make conceptual mistakes, but we, algebraic thing, you know, you can make mistakes, something in plus, minus, and all those things. And students, if they are following my derivation, they are saying, sir, here it should be plus, this not minus, here this should be this and that. So it becomes very effective. In that way, it's the two-way communication for interested students is guaranteed. But if there is a nice diagram, if there is a movie that you want to show, that you cannot show by traditional chalk and talk method. So it has to be a combination of these two things. The traditional good, so this is a philosophy of life that all of us, I think, should follow. That whatever are the traditional things, we should not discard. Whatever good things are there in the traditional thing, we should try to nurture that. On the top of that, we must adopt modern technology for the benefit. So this combination is what is important. And so for many of my courses, actually this is the thing that I follow. So partly wherever, you know, it is useful to show slides or videos to demonstrate things, because see, again, the style of teaching has changed a lot. So when we were students, another aspect of a good teacher was, at least in a scientific course, is that he or she could nicely draw diagrams. Okay, I don't think it is very relevant now, because if you have very good diagrams, just flash the diagrams, spend more time on explanation. I know some of our teachers who used to draw a power plant, you know, layout, and it will take 30 minutes out of the 60-minute class. I mean, the teacher would do it very effectively, but it's a wastage of time, right? Nobody will consider a power plant class as an art and craft class, right? So the thing is that the power plant layout should be there already. And if it's a simple layout, you can make a sketch. But if it's a very complex thing, you can flash it, and then you spend time to explain it, what is happening and all those things. That explanation is more important for the student. So by my statement, I must make it clear that I am not against use of modern gadget, but it has to be used judiciously with the classical paradigm of chalk and talk system. So one should not overdo anything, overdo the use of any of this. Inspirational and thought-provoking discussions. So this is something which I have already touched upon, and I must tell that this is one of the very good qualities of a teacher. Even if you have good grasp of fundamentals, this is not intrinsically ensured until or unless you nurture this. So every lecture, you try to have an inspirational perspective. You try to give a motivation to the students that they have some take home message at the end. So, the take home message is not about the details. The take home message is about, like, you know, if you are writing a paper, the take home message can be at the most like the abstract of the paper. An abstract in a very simple language, which can be like a newspaper article type of thing. And that message should be conveyed very clearly. Not for all subjects it is possible. See, the challenge about teaching is that all these ideas about teaching, they will vary significantly if you want to apply them in different subjects, for different subjects. A subject which is more descriptive needs to be taught in a different way as compared to a subject which is more mathematical. So, these things have to be adjusted accordingly. But what cannot be missed is something is that you should, you know, create motivation in the mind of the students. Entertain questions. So, entertaining questions is something which is not a good practice that we follow in most of our lectures. Most of our deliberations are one way or the other, and usually there are cases where serious doubts remained in the mind of the students, and these doubts are never resolved. And because these doubts are never resolved, this drags the student away from the subject. So, even if the question is a very basic question, you have to understand it from the perspective of the student. What you are teaching the student, you have gone through that subject once as a student in your own student life at least once. Then you have studied that subject and then you are telling it to the student. So, to the student, it is something which to you, it is something which may be very obvious, but the student is hearing that for the first time. So, it may not be that obvious to the student. And there are certain things in books you will find that from trivial algebra it follows. From straightforward analysis it appears. So, now nothing is trivial to a student, nothing is straightforward to a student. You assume that it can be trivial to the author who is writing the book. Maybe he also does not know how to derive it, he has copied it from somewhere, there it is written from trivial algebra, so he is also writing from trivial algebra. I have experienced all this, that is why I am saying. But nothing is trivial to a student. So, you do not expect that a student will understand every bit of thing that you are saying. So, entertain questions and try to address those and be honest. So, there are many cases when the student may ask a question for which you may not have a ready answer. You say that right now I am not having a ready answer, but I will go back, think over it and get back to you on this at the earliest opportunity. At least this much you say. This is very important. So, this actually will improve the communication between you and your student, and I think that will make teaching more effective. Respect the needs of the student. So, see, you know, as teachers, it is our common tendency that we do not respect needs of the student. You have to keep in mind that one important objective of the students is to get good grades in the exam. Whatever exam they are appearing, maybe the exam for which for the subject which you are teaching, maybe a competitive exam later on, maybe the exam in the form of a job interview, whatever. So, these are important things. So, one of my teachers used to make a remark that, you know, there are two types of good students. One is fundamentalist, another is Marxist. So, I mean, like politicians, I mean, fundamentalist is a student who wants to understand fundamentals, right? And Marxist, of course, I mean, you should not take my thing as a political statement, just take it very casually. And Marxist is a student who looks for Marx, you know. So whatever, say the interest of the student is only Marx. The student will not care for anything, but when you are actually showing the answer script, the student becomes most active. Will say, sir or mom, here I, please give me half mark more, with an understanding that in 20 questions, if you give half mark more, it will become 10 marks more. So, he or she will fight with you for life for getting this half mark. I mean, we have all experienced these kinds of students, but you must respect them, respect their needs. I mean, everybody you don't expect should be fundamentalists. So there will be some Marxists, and you respect their needs, and even if they expect that you train them in some way how to answer the exam properly, you give respect to that. By that I don't mean that you know give them question answer type of thing, you know, like solution books and all these things. But what I mean is that you respect their mindset, that in the back of the mind, it is always there that they want to do properly in the exams. As students, when we were students, we were also like that. I mean, maybe we were partly fundamentalist, partly Marxist, but can we say by very honestly that we were not Marxist at all? I think that will be a great lie if we are telling this. So if we have not practiced that as a part of our own student life, how can we expect the students to be like that? So let us honor that, and let us make sure that, you know, we give respect to their needs and make the teaching, you know, partly or majority wise fundamental concept, but also give some attention on what can be asked in the exam. So maybe make a brief review of all the things that you have taught before the exam, or give them some idea about what kinds of questions could be asked in the exam. Okay. So all these things, you know, add value to the course. These add practical values. These might not have conceptual values, but these add practical values. So teaching is a service. So we are giving service to a community, and service is not a one-way process. You must understand their expectations also, and accordingly you give a service. Do not merely reproduce textbook materials, but interpret in between lines. So this is, again, I started with the challenges in the Google era, and this is actually one follow up of that. So if you are reproducing material what is there in the book, you will see that students will easily lose interest from what you are teaching. Because you are teaching from one book, they will immediately browse the net and get thousands such materials, and they can go through the material of their own choice to learn that. For that they do not need you. Simple thing. In older times, for that also students needed teachers, because access to internet was not something which was technologically feasible. But now it is not the material, not the, you know, just the description for which the students are depending on you. So it's the synthesis of the material. So where reading in between lines is what is important, try to do that to the extent possible. Again, this issue varies from one subject to the other. It is very difficult to generalize it, but try to do it as much as possible. Try to discuss as much as possible. Balance of delivery styles between interactive and narrative. So, when you are interacting or when you are teaching in the class, some part of the discussion should be interactive. And I mean, I try to make sure that it is like that, but you know, sometimes because of time constraint, it may not be possible. So, there are many practical constraints. For example, you may be in a hurry to, you know, complete the syllabus. That is a practical thing. So, then if you entertain too many questions, there may not be a possibility that you actually can complete the syllabus within time. So, within the practical constraints, try to do that. Give examples from day-to-day life to create interest and develop knowledge. So, at the end of this presentation, I will illustrate this with some examples. The kinds of examples that we may give in the class, the kinds of examples that I have learned some of my seniors, how it can be given, and I will share with you a few examples that how to demonstrate concepts with examples. So, I can tell you the motivation. So, my son is now 7 years old. So, me and my wife, we thought that it is a good time that we start appointing a music teacher for him, because he is otherwise very interested in all this. So, I mean, as a ritual, we purchased a harmonium and we appointed a music teacher who comes once in a week to a very elderly and matured senior person, and he will give training. Now, the first day the teacher comes, so I was sitting there watching very carefully that what he teaches. So, what kind of music he can teach actually to a, you know, 7 year old guy. So, he starts with, you know, this is, you know, with sargam. So, sa, re, ga, ma, all these, all the details and all these things. So, I thought, oh my God, if I were a student, the first day I would have gone out and said enough is enough. So, for me, it would have been more attractive if the teacher teaches me how to sing a song which in the annual day of my school I can present, right, and then get into the grammar, right, rather than starting with the grammar and ending the life with grammar. And then at the end, I do not actually know how to write one sentence. I only know great grammar, what is conjunction, what is preposition, all these things, adjective, adverb, but I cannot put a sentence. So, this kind of teaching, I told my wife very clearly that this is not the kind of teaching that, you know, I like, but anyway we should respect, because neither me nor my wife are experts in music. So, whatever the expert is doing, we must honor and do all this. But I can only tell that had this kind of teaching been imposed on me at that age, maybe at this age I can, you know, absorb grammar, but if at that age, it would have, I would have, you know, thrown stones at that teacher. So, I mean, for everything, so there is the moral of the story is, for everything there is a grammar, true, but you may not always start with the grammar. But you can start with an example and then say, you know, to learn such examples, you and in a structured manner, you may go through this kind of grammar, and then grammar may follow, and that can be a much more effective teaching than starting with the grammar itself. And I see now, I go through very carefully the junior school books, just because of my son, the books are available, and in my leisure time, I want to see. I just see that how things have evolved in terms of writing books, and things have actually been very positive. So, in English, they are training students as words as doing words, naming words, instead of, you know, verbs and all these things. So, these technical names should be avoided as much as possible. So, if you tell a student doing word, then he or she can immediately relate. You know, what is a doing word? Now you say verb, I mean such a, you know, grave serious thing that it will, it does not make any impact. In our student life, I mean we had a, I mean Father Diablo, he used to teach these things and he was very effective. So he in those days, he said that, you know, I mean all of you may be knowing the Ren and Martin's grammar, English grammar book, the one of the Bibles. He said that, you know, Ren and Martin's book you read, that is fine, but you relate that grammar with, you know, what you are actually writing. You start learning writing small sentences, a collection of small sentences, and learn grammar through that way. Even in research, see, if you ask me how to write a good paper, I say you read a good paper and you try to reproduce something which looks similar to that. In that way you will learn how to write a good paper. Now if I go on, you know, writing grammar of writing a good paper, it does not help. So it is all about, you know, little bit of listening, mimicking, and that is how we actually get a style of doing a process. So at the end of this, I mean just after this slide, I will give you some examples, you know, how to teach through examples, some examples of that. Highlight on possible misconception on critical topics. So normally we talk about concepts, so we do not talk about misconceptions. And I thought that there are certain subjects where there are more misconceptions than concepts, like thermodynamics. You know, I mean we have, those of you who have studied thermodynamics will appreciate that we have studied, read books and all those things, still some concepts, you know, remain they remain still very fuzzy. And once I told my respected senior professor, Professor Shom, who has retired, that sir, let us write a book on concepts and misconceptions in thermodynamics. Then we were in a debate that there we will find no publisher for this. So because publishers want to publish only concepts, they do not want to publish misconceptions, right? So that particular project is now abandoned because sir has retired. If possible in a class, try to illustrate the misconceptions. This is very important, that I am teaching you these things. Now these could be possible sources of misconceptions, like in all experiments there are sources of errors. So similarly, while you are teaching, there could be sources of misconceptions. Tell the students that this is something, if you do not understand this properly, you might interpret it in this way, but that is wrong. This should be the correct way of interpreting. In all subjects it is there. So that can be highlighted. This can be one of the hallmarks of a good teacher. Finally, there cannot be a bad student, there can only be a bad teacher. So as teachers, we are habituated in classifying students as good, not so good, bad, whatever describing words, so to say, we can use. There cannot be any bad student, impossible. A student may have done badly in an exam, that does not mean that the student is bad student. There could be several reasons, and one possible reason is, as a teacher you have failed to motivate the student and that is why he or she has done bad. Or on the date of the exam, somehow the student was overstressed, and that is why these days I have stopped not relying on exams that much, because exams already enhance the stress level in the minds of the students. And some students actually cannot cope with that properly. Some students can, but some students cannot. You will find that in cricket, there have been stories about cricketers who do excellently in the net but fail in the match. The reason is that they may be technically well equipped, but temperamentally they cannot absorb the stress in the real match situation. So that kind of situation can be there for a student also. So it is not a question of whether the student is bad or good. The student has come through an admission process which is accepted by your university. That is how the student is there. He has not come out of nothing. So once the student has come and the student is accepted by the admission process of your institute, it is your responsibility to nurture the student. The student cannot be bad, but your teaching may be horrible. So then you blame all the things on the student. Like many of our colleagues say that we find students not coming to the class. This is a common complaint. I think many of you also make these complaints, and believe me or not, many of our IIT faculty members also make same complaint. So this is a universal Indian complaint, that in India this complaint is so much because actually students don't have to pay for each course that they are registering. So they don't mind, you know, they may come, they may not come. And here we are a bit possessive about this because we impose attendance. And in many of the foreign countries, students pay for the course, number one, and number two, attendance is not imposed. So it is, I mean, in both ways, it is different from what we are having in the Indian system. So have we ever thought, first of all, why is the student not coming to the class? More importantly, how does it matter if the student doesn't come to the class and does well in the exam? It only hurts your ego and nothing more than that. So for me, I have made a very simple policy. If a student doesn't come to the class and is able to answer all the questions that I am setting, possibly I am getting more trivial. So that is, I think the student should be given a credit to this, that the student, despite not attending my classes, has somehow prepared nicely and is able to answer the exam questions. So I would better depend on the performance of the student, and for me, a few students who are highly attentive is much better than large number of students sitting in the class just for giving attendance. This is absolutely very clear. So here I do not agree with the mindsets of many top educationists who think that attendance is a very important component in the class. I mean, it may be for disciplinary reasons. That is a different thing, that maybe when the student is not giving attendance, he is just lying idle and doing some activities which are not according to discipline. That is a different thing. That can be addressed differently. But so far as educational perspective goes, I don't think there is a much of a difference. So what I can say is that, you know, it's essentially not how good or how bad the student is. It's essentially how good or how bad as a teacher you are. That is where the improvement should come. So now, for the remaining 15-20 minutes before we call it a day, and maybe I will entertain questions from your side for another 10 minutes or so, I will try to illustrate with you some concepts through examples. So the first concept, so some are there in the slide, and at the end I will talk about some concepts, I mean, which I have not made a formal presentation, but I will tell in a storytelling type of form. So this is about concept of averaging. So averaging is a very deceptive thing, because by average we want to, you know, try to guess that what is the average behavior of a class or a system, whatever it is. But does it truly reflect that? If it truly doesn't reflect that, then the purpose of averaging is defeated. So I give an example like this. So this is, some of my students are sitting here, they have already seen this example in some of my lectures, so they can immediately relate to what I am going to talk about. So this is regarding a class. So there is a model where there are two extremes. One is a student of a genius type. See, this shows that quantification of everything can be a problem. So a genius student like Professor Einstein, we are giving an intellect of 3, right? This can be your psychology, one psychology problem. So and this student, by looking at the face, you understand how intelligent that the student is. So this student has intellect of 1. And in a class, you can have either of these students, but nothing in between. So this is the constraint of the class. This is how the model is developed. So there is a teacher who joins the university with a lot of hope that he or she will teach good students. See, as teachers, we always like to teach good students. We are very happy, and see, this is our intrinsic, you know, characteristic as a teacher. We always love our good students, no matter whether they love us, but we always love them. So, this is a intrinsic quality of any teacher. So in the first semester, this teacher is teaching a class where there is only one student. And so normally in IIT, if it is less than 5 students, a class will not be there. But this is a hypothetical university, not IIT. So there, in the first semester, a student having intellect like Professor Einstein appears, and therefore the average intellect in his class is 3. But you know, life is life is uneven, and so in the next semester, the same teacher gets this class. Some of you are trying to relate your students with this. I can understand from your faces. So then all students are of this type, and that means the average is 1. Third semester, you know, is little bit balancing. So you get a student who is having intellect 3, another student who is having intellect 1. So the average is 2, very simple arithmetic. Now the big question is, what is the average intellect of all the students that this teacher has taught? Okay, this is the question. So if you see, if you use the simple law of arithmetic, you have 16 students. If you count, it will come out to be 16. In 3 semesters, total value of the intellect is 2 into 3, 2 times this intellect 3, and 14 times 1. So total 20. Okay. So now you can estimate the average intellect of the student in these ways, these two ways. One is this 20 total out of 16 cases. So 20 divided by 16, 1.25. Another is you average of the averages of the semesters. So 3 plus 1 plus 2 by 3, 2. And you see these two averages are grossly different. So why this kind of difference is coming? Same average, it is same arithmetic mean. The problem is that every population size is heavily biased towards a particular nature of elements in the population, and that can significantly affect the law of averaging. So instead of telling this concept that is a population biased by overpresence of some elements may lead to an error in average based prediction, you start with this example and give that conclusion. I think that can be effective. So, there can be a significant difference when there is a correlation between class size and quality of students in the class. Second example is concept of conservation. So, this is also very important in engineering. I believe many of you are engineering teachers. So, in engineering we talk about mass balance, momentum balance, energy balance. These things are very common and we write simple laws to represent these balances, and the simplest to the toughest subjects, they actually talk about some kinds of these balances, maybe in forms of differential equation or whatever, but physically this picture. So, this is the mathematical exercise that I go through. I will quickly browse through this, and somebody who is not interested with this, with just this, will so you want to see the next slide? Okay. So, this is a slide taken from the net. This I have not created, so I must tell this. So, now maybe I will just skip this slide. This is not so good for many. So, so if you go through this mathematics, for some students it is a problem. Nowadays it is more problem because actually engineering students are very sharp, but they do not want to go through this mathematics. They say that enough is enough, we have studied good mathematics to clear JE. After that, we do not think it is more relevant. So, this conservation law, I give a simple example. I say that these days balance of mass, balance of momentum, balance of energy does not make much of a sense, but you talk about balance of money, that makes a lot of sense. Now, everybody is excited because that is what we are looking for throughout our life. So, somebody has gone to a bank, say this old style bank, a physical bank, not this mobile bank. So, physical bank has deposited some money to open an account where every month his or her salary will be deposited. So, this person after 1 or 2 months visits the bank to physically withdraw some money from the bank, not ATM and all these things. So, physically he visits there. So, when he visits there, he already knew that what money he deposited, he already knew that what is the salary that has come, and he withdraws some part of that, and he finds that there is some money which is left in the account which is little bit beyond what the difference between all these, and this is because of the interest that has accumulated. So, that is nothing but the law of balance, in minus out plus generated equal to change. So, something has come in the bank account, something has gone out of the bank account, something has generated out of interest, and that is the net change in your bank account. So, now if you write simple mathematical expressions to relate this in, out, change, you can come up with very complicated differential equations very simply, and students will be able to follow this. So, I think I have almost come to the end of my talk, and the last thing as an example I will talk about is something. So, I have talked about fluid mechanics, and some of you who may be from electrical engineering or related subjects will feel that I am giving more examples from that. So, I will talk about an example which in physics or in electrical sciences is a very common law, which is Lenz's law. So, Lenz's law in electromagnetism talks about there is something which opposes the very cause to which it is due. So, I had a very reputed teacher in my class 11-12, he used to be my private tutor in physics, but I respect him as one of my best teachers. His name is Professor Gomes from the St. Xavier's College, Kolkata. He has retired now, of course. So, Professor Gomes, when he was introducing the Lenz's law, he told a beautiful thing. So he said that, see, Lenz's law is the law of nature. You do something good for somebody, that person will be the first person to be against you. And so, and that I have seen is really the law of nature. And so, no law of teaching, no law of engineering, no law of physics can be against or violating the law of nature. And at the end, Professor Gomes told, I mean, he was a very open-minded person. He was a Christian, but he said that, don't you think that Lord Ramakrishna also told about this? So these are the kinds of teachers that we all had, and whatever good or bad teacher I have become because of the excellent nurturing of all these teachers. And I must end this talk with a due tribute to all these teachers who have enabled us to grow. Thank you very much.